You have named the book The Courtesan, the Mahatma and the Italian Brahmin. Why this name? What made you give this title to the book?
It is a somewhat serpentine title, but one of the reasons I chose it is because the three words in it, the courtesan, the Mahatma and the Italian Brahmin, the three phrases there, it sort of encapsulates the three interests that I have in this book. And they're not explained in an academic sense, but these are the three basic themes. One is caste, the other is gender, and the third is human eccentricity and human quirk, because I think Indian history is full of these elements. So the Italian Brahmin, for example, refers to the human quirk, the eccentricity. It refers to this Italian. He's from a noble family, born in the late 16th century. He lands up in India in 1604 as a missionary. He's well connected. He's descended from a Holy Roman Emperor. He's got a pope up his family tree, and he decides that he's going to come here, start converting people to the Catholic faith. Except once he gets here, he realizes that the only converts the Portuguese are making at the time were low caste fishermen. And he says, no, I want the high caste to convert. I want I'm going to save the Hindus by becoming a Hindu. So he orchestrates a transfer to this Christian mission in Madurai in 1606. So he's gone deep into the peninsula, in the heart of the peninsula. And in Madurai, he starts doing this most peculiar in some ways, but also a most imaginative thing, which is that he transforms himself into a Brahmin. So first he starts wearing the punul, or the sacred thread of a Brahmin. He starts wearing saffron robes like a sannyasi. He ditches the plate. He says the plate is too European. He's going to start eating out of a plantain leaf. He says that Brahmins must cook his food because now he's become one of them. And he creates a veritable caste system with his own colleague, this other Jesuit, and tells the other Jesuit that I can't eat with you anymore because you're a Mlecha and I'm a Brahmin. So this man essentially transforms himself into a Brahmin and decides that he's going to preach the Bible as a kind of lost Veda. And all of this is happening in 1606. And he learns Telugu, he learns Sanskrit, he learns Tamil, all these languages. He starts debating Brahmins on the Vedas and on religious principle. And when his colleagues in Goa get very upset and they summon him angrily to Goa, he essentially goes there and refuses to eat even with them. And he uses his family connections in Rome to get the Pope to justify his Indianized methods of conversion. And where there were zero missionary converts where he first came, by the end of his career he had about 5,000 people he'd managed to convert. It included a prince, it included very many Brahmins, and he was treated like any other holy man that existed in South India. He was a sannyasi, and there's an old picture of him from the time that shows him in his saffron robes. So that refers to the human eccentricity, the fact that Indian history has colourful characters like this. The courtesan could refer to one of half dozen courtesans who appear in the book. Because the larger question I'm asking is that in 2019, why are we still doing Indian history where it's all about kings, a few empires, and a few battles, and five dates? Indian history is much richer than that. It's more important to recognize the fact that history wasn't entirely made by men. The men have been writing history for all this time, but it is important to realize that they were not the only actors who made history. So the courtesans could, for example, refer to Begum Samru, who in the 18th century begins life as a dancing girl in pretty much impoverished circumstances in Chandni Chowk in Delhi. Over the next few decades, she marries a German mercenary called the Butcher of Patna. When he dies, she takes over his armed forces and becomes the head of an army. In the middle, she has an affair with an Irishman. She ends up marrying a Frenchman. Her troops are very upset with her marriage to the Frenchman, so they tie her to a gun carriage and leave her out to sort of dehydrate and die in the sun for an entire week. She survives that, she bounces back, reclaims her army, goes on to become protector of the Mughal Emperor Shah Alam. When Shah Alam's capital in Delhi is besieged, it's Begum Samru, this ex-dancing girl, married to a bunch of Europeans, who actually rides to his rescue. And she becomes titled protector of the Mughal Emperor. And by the end of her life, she's allied to the East India Company and one of the richest women in North India. This was a woman who contributed to history. This was a woman with a story that is sensational. But she's not the only one. There was the other Devadasi called Balamani in the 19th century, who was one of the earliest people in South India to set up a private limited company. Hers was the Balamani Drama Company. And this is a time when most South Indian women are still illiterate. And here she's running one of the most successful drama businesses of the time. So much so that there were trains that were called Balamani Expresses, because they used to stop in Kumbakonam for a fixed few hours when passengers could get off, go to her stage, view one of these plays, and then come back and resume their journey. So it could refer to Balam. It could refer to Gauhar Jan, who was one of the second, really, but for all practical purposes, the first person to sing for the gramophone. And that she made history there. She was also contributing to art and culture. It could refer to the so-called Bhagmati of Hyderabad, who nobody knows even whether she existed. She probably didn't. But her story is central to the myth, the founding myth of Hyderabad. She's got a certain value. That myth has a certain value. So the stories of these women are all around Indian history, but we've never really looked at it. A Victorian historian, if you suggest that Indian history could be told through the eyes of these public women, as they were called, who were not policed by Mangal Sutras and the tag of marriage, who had too much autonomy which unsettled men, then they would have laughed. But the thing is, it is a fact that they contributed. And the Mahatma, of course, in the title, one would imagine it refers to Gandhiji, because there is an essay on Gandhiji in the book. But the real reference is to Mahatma Phule, because he's one of those people we've garlanded and put on a pedestal and blandly describe him as a social reformer. But he represents the fact that in Indian history, there's always been polemicism, there's always been polemical thought and radical thought. You know, Phule was the man who grew up in Pune. He's the grandson of a Mali, a gardener. His father was a greengrocer. He obtains an education merely because he goes to a mission school, starts reading Thomas Paine's Rights of Right of Man and so on, and really starts thinking in a very original fashion. So Pune is this ultra-orthodox city where, you know, the Brahmins are extremely powerful, the seat of orthodoxy in Western India. And where, you know, they say that we are superior because we were born from the head of the cosmic creator. Phule turns around and asks whether the cosmic creator also menstruated through the mouth. And this to say, when you're a Mali's grandson, to say it in a city like Pune, it took not only spine, but it also took a mind that was very strong. And he wasn't the only one. You look at Kabir, the same argument, the Brahmins are superior because they were born from the head of the cosmic creator. Kabir says, were they delivered through the ear? You know, when the Turks said that we are superior to the Hindus, he said, well, why weren't you all born circumcised if you were so superior? So, you know, there's a few centuries before Phule, you have polemicism there again. And even earlier, if you go to Basava in the 12th century, even more radical,
fantastic story.
Where he talks about how loaded with the weight of the Vedas, the Brahmin is a veritable donkey. Now, he's saying that in the 12th century.
Actually, you should tell the Basava story.
Basava, I'm assuming, know that he's a preceptor of the
Vedas, really. I did not tell Aryan.
He's this Brahmin who lived in the 12th century and really begins this anti-caste movement and anti-priest movement all the way back in the 12th century. Not only is his voice very sharp and punctures a lot of social conventions, because he's a Brahmin, he could get away with it. The movement really eventually only died out and then eventually had to resurrect itself when Basava did something scandalous, which was an inter-caste marriage. So in the 12th century, he got a Dalit son married to a Brahmin's daughter. And that's when his entire movement, the king sort of came down on them, they were lynched and thrown out, and there was violence, and Basava ended up dying a year later. But it's funny that in the 12th century, an inter-caste marriage provoked that. And even 2 weeks ago, there was a report of this guy, a 17-year-old boy who went and shot his sister in the head because she'd gone and done an inter-caste marriage. That was in the 12th century, we're in the 21st, but that's not changed because caste has always been in the room.
So he created the Lingayat community to get out of Hinduism.
Yeah, and he. What was interesting is that for one, he gives women a lot of space. So out of the 219 odd Lingayat sages as they were, 35 are women, which by the general proportions of Indian history is pretty large. Many of them were unmarried. Many of these were women with original minds, but in those days, you know, you had to couch everything original in vocabulary of devotion and God, because that's the only way you could get away with saying radical things. Pretend it's about God, and it becomes easier to express strange and new ideas. So, you know, these women in their own right are interesting. They also have very sharp, direct poetry, like Basava. And one thing is interesting, which is that across religions in India, and across castes and social practice, menstruation was considered a sin. Like, it was considered impure. You know, women were considered impure when they had their periods. Basava is the only person who said this does not taint you in any way. You're allowed to worship God. You're allowed to go about your day as normal. It doesn't matter what time of the month it is. In the 12th century. So it was quite remarkable that he managed to do that. And they all eventually, as I said, this inter-caste marriage causes them to flee. But despite that, his poetry, the vachanas he's left behind, they're so sharp, so pointed, that you realize that 12th century Basava, Kabir a few centuries later, Phule in the 19th century, and Ambedkar in the 20th, polemical, radical thought, standing up and asking questions is also part of the Indian tradition. One of the things I want to challenge is this notion that our ancestors were all sitting with their spines erect and thinking noble thoughts all day long and chanting mantras and reading the Ramayana. They weren't. They were capable of asking tough questions. They were capable of original thought, and that we need to resurrect. Indian culture is not merely about obeying orders. It's also about questioning those orders and being able to call a spade a spade. So although the essays are written in a fun, sort of irreverent fashion, these are the broad themes. I don't bring it together in an academic way. Nowhere does it say that these are the themes I'm looking at. But the title for me represents that. It doesn't, and the Mahatma is not Gandhiji. The Mahatma for me is Phule in the title.
And that is what comes out. There is a very interesting story on the women with no breasts. Would you like to tell us about that?
Yeah, the essay is called The Woman with No Breasts, which is a story from Kerala. But I'll give you some context for this. You know, in Kerala till the 1920s, even wearing blouses was not very normal. So most people went about topless, and that was perfectly normal. There was no morality, there was no judging people on the basis of what they wore. Everybody was uniformly topless. So the first Brahmin woman to wear a blouse in the 1920s was excommunicated because they thought blouses were a scandalous thing. I mean, the first Brahmin men to wear shirts and sit down for a meal were also threatened with excommunication because toplessness was the norm. But there are fascinating stories. There was this one social reformer in Thrissur. His name escapes me, but he had gone to study in Madras. So he came back saying, I'm going to make all the Malayali women virtuous. They've got to start wearing blouses. So he puts together this procession of women wearing blouses. It's a big new thing in Thrissur, this notion of women wearing blouses. So he gets about a dozen women to wear blouses and come out in a procession. And such was the sensation this concept of women in blouses caused, that a crowd gathered that was so large that these 12 women got so paranoid and upset and taken aback that they threw their blouses off and ran away. The Maharaja of Travancore had a British resident who told him, all your palace servants are walking about topless. This is not civilized. So they must all start wearing blouses. Maharaja said, fine, and he issued the relevant orders. But the first thing the palace servants did as they exited the gate of the palace was to get rid of the blouse. Because they didn't feel the need to objectify themselves. If they covered themselves, it was considered a negative thing. And my favorite anecdotal information on this is of Aubrey Menon, the novelist and writer. His Ramayana Retold was a work of satire that was one of the earliest books banned in India. He talked about how his Irish mother came to Kerala to meet her Malayali mother-in-law. And the mother-in-law said, fine. She sent a maid saying, you know, I will now receive my daughter-in-law. And the maid came running back saying, you know, she's sitting there with her breasts covered. And the mother-in-law said, if she's covering herself, she must be preparing for adultery. Because that was the notion that if you covered yourself, you were not dignified. The reason this changed is the Victorians coming. Now the Malayali men start going to college where they've got classmates from all over the place. And suddenly they're being told that their mothers are not virtuous. Kerala had polyandry. So where you have polygamy with men having multiple wives, in Kerala there was the option for women to have multiple husbands. And so suddenly they were told that your women are not in control, their bodies are out of control, their habits are out of control, they're not even dressed in a civilized manner. They need to be reined in. And that this causes such angst for the Malayali man that they have to somehow police women's bodies. So the earliest Malayali magazines talk about how we will never publish anything related to politics and economics. We will publish stories that energize the moral conscience, which is what? Listen to your husband, let him manage your property, wear a blouse, sit in the kitchen, take care of kids. Creating this chaste kulastri, as they call it in Sanskrit, as opposed to this earlier version which was no longer considered kosher. So this is the context in which this woman with no breasts happens. Because there is this notion that the covering of breasts was an upper caste privilege and lower caste women were the only ones it didn't cover, which is not true. Even Brahmin women didn't cover. The story of this lady is Nangeli was this lady who died somewhere in the early 19th century. And the story goes that in those days lower castes had to pay a tax. It was a poll tax, where the logic is that if you're lower caste, you're essentially a unit of muscle that's meant to do work. So anything that is not productive is taxed. So there's, for men it's called talakaram, because your physical labor, you don't need your head. That's not no use to do your physical labor. So there's a tax on it. There's a tax on mustaches. I mean, if you twirl your mustache this way, the tax was a certain amount. For women similarly, there was a mulakaram, or the breast tax, which is a poll tax, because this is not a productive unit of labor. So you've got to pay tax for this privilege that you have of having a breast. So one day the tax collector shows up demanding this, and this lady is starving, she's got no money. She does this heroic thing where she cuts off her breast, puts it on a plantain leaf, and gives it to them and collapses and dies. Now the thing is, this often, you know, provokes a lot of ire in the right-wing circles, online especially, on Twitter, etc. Where they say there's no record of Nangeli, there's no document that says this ever happened. And that's the other thing about history, right? If you're looking at documents, documents only privilege certain castes. It's only literacy that brings you documents. If you're illiterate, if you're a lower caste person, your history is in lore, it's in song, it's in tradition, it's in these heroes who survive in myths. Whether they existed or not is not the point, but the myth is serving a point. That myth has a certain value. So Nangeli, we don't know the dates, we don't know if she's a physical person, if she existed. But the fact that the story existed is a form of resistance, and that has value. And resistance in Kerala, you know, it's quite fascinating. My mother's family, they were this very feudal family. And they had what we call adiyan. So essentially, for all practical purposes, bonded labor. These people had absolutely no rights, even till the 1940s. Legally, they did it. In practice, they didn't. So every time they had a baby in the family, they were allowed to come to one corner where they couldn't look at the house. There were enough trees covering it. Because if they looked at our house, the house would be polluted. And they were supposed to yell from there, Kadavi Kadavitu, which in Malayalam somehow somewhere translates to she has laid it, like it's an animal or something. They can't use words like pregnancy, birth, none of that is allowed. And whatever the head of the family felt was the choice of name for the child was the name of the child. So they, all these people were given names like tall one, short one, fat one, you know, these were the kind of names. They had no proper names that were allowed to them. In my own childhood, I remember a lady whose name was White One, you know, Fair One. That was her actual name, Velumbi. But they had their forms of resistance also. So they, in my family, they were not allowed to address members of the family by name. They'd say, you know, my lord, my lady, that kind of, that was the vocabulary they used in Malayalam. And calling anybody from the family by name was a crime, essentially. But they had an interesting way of resisting this, because one day my great-grandmother, whose name is Kalyani, she's standing in the veranda of the house, and she hears in the distance a very rough, someone roughly saying, Eddie Kalyani, which is a very rough way of addressing a woman. And then she goes out to inquire, she sends out somebody to find out, and it turns out all these adiyans, or these bonded laborers in the fields, they named all the farm animals after members of the family. So they can hit a Madhavan, they can yell at a Kalyani, they can beat up, you know, various members of the family and take out their frustration on the animals. It's an almost comical way of resisting this. We have this notion that back in the day there was an ecosystem and caste gave everybody a place, etc. They were never happy in it. They were always trying to find ways to resist it. They would not do it to your face, but they were doing it in secret. When the cow is called Kalyani, which is the name of your mistress, and you're flogging it and beating it, you're getting some sort of punch out of it. So the story is, this woman with no breast is merely one of such stories where there are, in some ways, entertaining, comical, but also very sharp protests against caste, which we, I think, need to acknowledge. Because trying to get away from caste when you're dealing with Indian history is impossible.
And then you have two more very interesting stories which I really liked. One was on Mirabai and one was on Meenakshi, the goddess. That is something that many may not know about Meenakshi. Would you like to say?
Actually, before I go there, since we're on the topic of caste, there's the second essay in the book is called A Maratha Prince's Morality Play.
I was about to
It's also a parody of the caste system. So in the early, in the late
17th
century,
about that. That's very interesting.
There's a Maratha prince, Shivaji's direct nephew, his half-brother's son, who comes to power as a 12-year-old in Tanjavur. And this Tanjavur is a fascinating court because the people are Tamilians, the court language is Telugu, and the king is a Marathi speaker. And he writes this wonderful Telugu play called Satidana Suramu, which basically translates as Take My Wife. And it's a parody of the caste system and social conventions, because the protagonist of the play is this Brahmin called Morobatlu the Magnificent. And Morobatlu the Magnificent, with his disciple, he's on his way to a temple festival. Now on the way, he sees a very beautiful woman in the distance, and he says, halt, you know, I want to go flirt with her. And his disciple is flabbergasted. He says, you know, think of the Vedas, think of eternal bliss, think of spiritual concepts and the subtle meanings of Vedic words and so on. And the man says, no, I don't care about that. I don't care about insipid bliss when I can have the bliss that comes from spending a night with this lady. So then he finally goes there and starts flirting with the lady. But she turns around, and it turns out that she is an untouchable, a Dalit woman. She's a lower caste woman. And the irony is that she turns around and tells him things about Dharma and Shastra and Artha, saying, no, you know, you're a high caste Brahmin, you can't have any dealings with me. And there's this one line where she says, I drink liquor, I eat beef. So you as a Brahmin cannot have dealings with me. And he says, we worship cows and we drink cow's milk. You eat the entire cow, you must be purer than me. And this is happening, this is a play written in the early 18th century. Because in the early 18th century, we still have the cultural confidence to laugh at ourselves. We still have the cultural confidence to lampoon social conventions. We still have the confidence to be able to take things lightly and express a sense of humor. If a writer were to write this dialogue today in a play, you can imagine the scandal and the fuss it would cause.
You are saying this play was performed there in public?
It was performed in public in the temple during festivals. So it wasn't merely in the court by the king for a secret audience. It was performed for the public, which meant he was communicating to them also that, you know, this is all, it's a little bit of a sham. Yeah. And kings know this best because they are people who manipulated the caste system as they liked. In my first book, The Ivory Throne, there's this king called Marthandavarma, who, you know, he's a conqueror. He's first among equals for the longest time. But he realizes that he needs to somehow sanctify royal blood. Royal blood has to be made sacred so that nobody spills it easily. It's a way of building security for the state. and the king. So he does this very interesting thing where he decides that I need to wear the punur. I need a sacred thread like pure kshatriya. So this man is a Naya. So what he does is he acquires a cow with all the right lakshanas, which is the spots in the right place, the tail shape the right way, etc. This cow is brought to the capital in a great ceremony, and they construct a golden model of this cow, an enormous model. The man goes in, the king goes in through the mouth of the cow. He sits inside the cow for a certain duration. The Brahmins pelt it with gomutra and flowers and chant mantras of birth. And then he emerges from under the tail of the cow. And now suddenly he's descended from the sun and the moon, and he's a pure kshatriya from whatever race. He can choose what he wants. And of course the Brahmin priest who helps him gets to keep the golden cow. And this wasn't merely him. One of the Nayaka rulers in Tamil Nadu, here the ceremony was even more inventive, because when he popped out from under the tail of the cow, he had to land into the Brahmin priest's wife's lap, where she pretended to be his mother and he had to wait like a baby. Because this was them constructing a sense of awe around themselves. And then you have a protocol that evolves around them. You know, the kids in the school this morning were quite amused when I told them how vocabulary around the royal family was very artificial. But it was artificial for a purpose. They had to, you had to reinforce every day this royal family, this person in power is special. So when you and I wake up in the morning in Malayalam, we say palladekwa, to brush your teeth. But the royal family, they never brush their teeth. It's called Tirumutta Vilaka, which is the cleaning of the royal pearls. Because in the royal family, they don't do ordinary things like brushing their teeth. When they went out for a walk, it was called Edunalata, royally proceeding. You never walk. When the queen got pregnant, queens didn't give birth or do such things as getting pregnant. The announcement always said Thiruvayaravanu, the royal womb is occupied. And then when the queen finally delivered, you'd never say the queen had a baby. You'd say Thiruvayaravanu, the royal womb is vacated.
The royal womb.
And every time a Maharaja was on his deathbed, they would find a Tamil Brahmin to come and hug him. The idea being that in that embrace, the Maharaja was transferring all his sins, and the Brahmin would then be taken to the border of the state, given 10,000 rupees and sent off. And the Maharaja could go to his maker, quietly thinking that he was finally getting moksha because all his sins had been given off to a surrogate. And then of course when they died, the word was never died. The word was Nadanini, which means you've gone from ruling this kingdom to ruling the next kingdom. When the queen went for a bath, it was called Pallinira, the royal frolic in water. Because baths are for ordinary people. The queen's only frolic in water. So, you know, all of this is doing what? It's constructing a sense of awe. It's building a sense of specialness around members of this family. But the interesting thing about power is you need legitimacy. You need rituals to sanctify power. But once the hard thing slips away, all of this collapses like a house of cards. So the last Maharani of Travancore, who's a subject in my first book, she had 300 servants. Every time she came from the upper floor to the ground floor, all of them had to bow 7 times, not 6, not 8, exactly 7 times, touching the ceiling and touching the floor. This very elaborate bowing and all of that. Every time she went out, they'd fire a 21-gun salute. Every time she went for a drive, there'd be 16 people holding up a parasol and standing like that around her. All of this was trying to tell people that she was a special person. It existed till 1949. By 1956, the communists are in power in Kerala. Her own palace servants, the same servants who were bowing to her 7 times, you know, the drop of a hat, day in and day out, they hoisted a communist flag on top of the palace and formed the palace union. All it took was less than a decade, once the real thing slipped away, for all this protocol, all this legitimacy, all this ritualism that existed to slip away very quickly and become meaningless. And that is interesting, because all of Indian history is about kings seeking legitimacy. Mere power is not enough. Power makes you a warlord, power makes you a powerful warrior maybe, but to be a king, you really have to find ways to legitimize yourself. And you have to keep doing these rituals day in, day out, to ensure that it is cemented on a regular basis. Because otherwise it's a fickle mistress, it will slip away very quickly. And you know, that's what you see even with the Marathas and Tanjavur, etc. After a while, you know, all of this fades away. And it becomes empty rituals, empty slogans, empty emotions that actually don't mean much anymore.
That's a very interesting observation. One more incident that you wrote about I thought was fascinating, and that is the Dalit at the temple door. I think you should tell us about that. And then we'll move on to the Raj and after.
That refers to a Bhakti saint called Chokamela. Now this is interesting with Bhakti also, right? Bhakti people often assume is an anti-caste, an original sort of movement that expresses new ideas, it's anti-ritual, anti-priest. But even within the Bhakti movement, there's a caste system. If you're an upper caste person, you have the social privilege to pack a punch in your statements. So, you know, there are upper caste saints like Tukaram. He wasn't very high caste, but he was a tailor, which meant he was a Shudra, but he was within the Varna system. He had a place within the Varna system. So his message could be much more direct. It could be much more pointed. But a Chokamela was a Mahar. He was a Dalit man. he always had to be doubly certain that anything he said was uncontroversial. So this was a man who, even when God appears in these miracles in front of Chokamela, he'll help Chokamela drag away a dead cow, he'll help Chokamela with his work, but he'll never tell Chokamela to actually enter the temple, because Chokamela is also being very careful that he doesn't actually flout any rules. And even when he finally passes away, the legend goes that his bones were found chanting the name of God, etc. And the Brahmin said, "Oh, wonderful devotee, we must give him a memorial, a samadhi." But the samadhi is where? Outside the temple gate. Exactly where all his life he had to stand is exactly where his memorial was also finally placed. And in the 18th century, the Peshwas who were ruling in Pune, they put out a rule saying that Dalits can't come and worship here anymore because Brahmins going in are getting touched by their sweat and bodies. So they have to stay away from there. So the Dalits had to move, and Chokamela was finally lost alone over there, you know, sort of lamenting the fact that he was always destined to stand at the door. And there are lots of tragic figures like that. But despite the tragedy, despite the lack of privilege, he still managed to put out a message, which was that this is unfair. So there are always voices that stood up to the status quo and asked the tough questions when they needed to be asked.
Very interesting. Very, very interesting. While you were in your Raj section, one essay that I thought was extraordinary was on Periyar. In fact, I'll read the opening parts of the Periyar story. He says, Periyar said, "There is no God. There is no God at all. He who created God is a fool. He who propagates God is a scoundrel. He who worships God is a barbarian." This is what Periyar was, and he was at the same time as Gandhi.
He was, in fact, in many ways the anti-Gandhi. Where Gandhi wore white, he wore black. Where Gandhi renounced sex in his 30s, Periyar married a 30-year-old in his 70s. When Gandhi began all his public meetings with bhajans and, you know, devotional songs to God, Periyar began all his public meetings denying the existence of God. Periyar is the man who said that Gandhiji suggested celibacy as a way to sort of control the population and control desire and all of that. Periyar said, you know, sleep with whoever you want as much as you want, but women, be careful, don't get pregnant too often because you will lose control over your bodies. And he also said, women don't expect men to come and save you. You know, have foxes ever, you know, save chickens and things like that? He gives these wonderful animal analogies, saying don't expect men to come and save you because they've always got a different agenda there. So he was in favor of contraception. This is at a time when Margaret Sanger, the great birth control expert, comes and Gandhiji refuses to sort of endorse her thing, saying that this is sinful and so on, and Periyar has no issues with it. And Periyar was also in many ways provocative. This is a man who garlanded idols with chappals, who sort of burnt copies of sacred books and so on. He, you know, there are moments where you're very disturbed also with Periyar's extremism. But what is interesting is that he held up a mirror at a time when everybody was blaming the foreigner as the kind of villain of the story. Periyar said, no, there are villains within as well. And we have to acknowledge that. If we are truly going to become a better society, we have to acknowledge the fact that within also we need reform. You can't get away from the fact that, you know, you can merely blame an outsider for being the villain of the piece and escape all the internal contradictions that exist in the country. So with his black and with his anti-Gandhi message, it's really striking how he...
But
you know, formed such an
impact. He also had a huge impact. He changed the thinking of that region for almost permanently.
Which is why, in general, in South India, the nationalist struggle wasn't merely about pushing the British out. It was also about caste reform. It was also about social reform. The peninsula's trajectory in the nationalist movement also is very different. They're not merely interested in... I mean, a lot of the South Indian... in the 1930s, people often assume that it was only after independence that we came into government. But Congress formed government in eight provinces of India in the late 1930s, 37, 38, till the Second World War, when they finally resigned. For a few years, they were in power. And as early as that, you already hear of corruption, you already heard of nepotism, you already heard of people using this as a patronage network. Because in the South, they were happy to get into government. They were interested in getting into government. And there are records of the time where, you know, they say Nehru and all are against this, but the southern units of the Congress Party are very keen to cooperate with the British constitution and take part in government. Because in the South, it wasn't about British equal to bad, Indian equal to good. It was a much more complicated conversation, the results of which you still see in South India. You know, caste still exists, of course, everywhere, but it's not as pointed and horrible as some parts of the North, for example, because it's been addressed in the South. People have looked in it in the eye, and there have been people who've taken it head on. which helps because that's why women are treated much better in the South, marginally, I would say. I mean, they still don't have it fair. But in general sense, if you compare the two regions, women have it better in the peninsula because these things have been addressed and taken head on. So it's important, I think, to hold up a Periyar, even though he says uncomfortable things that about God not existing, and people didn't like that. His atheism was very unusual for the time. But his saying that was important because you always need a person there to ask you those uncomfortable things and remind you of those internal contradictions.
You were talking of the British and its impact. How do you see the British rule having impacted our social lives?
It's not a black and white question again. I highlight several Englishmen in this book. Now we take Queen Victoria. Now after the 1857 rebellion, she passes that famous proclamation and she says, I guarantee your religion, I guarantee all of this. And in the 1870s, she declares herself Empress of India. Now in our flat reading of history, Victoria, Imperial Lady, declares herself Empress. That's about it. But if you look at her own side of the story, it's actually fascinating and almost comical. One of the reasons she was determined to become Empress of India was because her daughter was married to the German Emperor's son. And she was completely paranoid that one day her daughter would outrank her. So she was determined that she must also be an empress so her children are not outranking her over the years. So there's a personal reason then why she wanted to become empress. The other thing is, we assume that the British were one solid bloc which supported all these activities, but they didn't. Her assumption of the title empress passed through parliament with a very slim majority because English society was horrified that she was making claims to imperial status. So the compromise was in the UK she would always be queen. She would only be Empress of India. She would never be addressed as Her Imperial Highness. She would remain a Royal Highness at home. In India, she would be Empress. Because they said at home, you can't expect to be an Imperial anything. And what's interesting also is that she was at some level also a lonely lady. Her husband had died and she was lonely. And India gave her something to do. Because in domestic politics in Britain, she had no role. But in foreign policy, her own government allowed her a certain role. And she had such an appetite for India that people were sending her petitions left, right and center. They were having a property dispute in a village in Telangana, they'll send her a petition on it. Someone protests the introduction of income tax, they'll send her a petition on it saying, your proclamation said you won't intervene in our culture and customs, why have you introduced income tax? This is in the 1860s. So she'll start intervening in all of this. So eventually her secretariat started censoring her mail because the Queen was so anxious to contribute and participate in Indian conversations that she was accepting anything and everything that came her way. So they had to start rerouting her mail all the way back to India to the Governor General so he could handle it and put these people in order because she was dying to participate. The other person I highlight, for example, is Sir Arthur Cotton. Now again, this was an evangelist. He was sternly of the belief that, you know, the British were here to civilize Indians and so on. But even today on his birthday, it's celebrated like a Jayanti in parts of that Godavari belt area. Because this is the man who irrigated that entire region. So the British were obsessed with building railways because they could turn a big profit out of it. He used what we now call jugaad, or like old, fairly frugal methods. And he irrigated this entire thousands and thousands and thousands of acres. There's an estimated 3,000 busts and statues of Arthur Cotton to this day in that area.
Really?
I found out because when I was doing my first book, I went to meet one of the descendants of the family because a later Cotton family member was a British resident in Travancore. And this man said, I've just come back from India because they had this Jayanti for my ancestor and we were invited as state guests by the chief minister. And I said, what are you talking about? It turns out they were invited as chief guests by the government and there was a big mala and garlanding and a big function around Arthur Cotton's birth anniversary. It was an important birth anniversary because he's still venerated and respected in that area for what he did. Someone like William Jones is he started the Asiatic Society in Bengal. He was also he said, I'm never going to preach democracy to the Indians. But he did think Indian history had something of value. The Orientalists are the ones who reminded us that Ashoka existed. They're the ones who translated a lot of texts from Sanskrit into English and gave them a new lease of life. In the early 19th century, there was still a time when Devdasis from Pondicherry were sailing all the way to Europe and performing for the French king. They were performing at the biggest theatres in London because there was an appetite for it. Shakuntala, the story of Kalidasa Shakuntala, when William Jones translated it, Goethe went completely obsessed with it. And he said, Shakuntala needs to be kissed because he said she's such a fascinating heroine. So, this was a time when that racism hadn't yet infected British policy in India. And at this time, they were willing to engage with Indian culture. They didn't see contemporary Indians as their equals. That has to be acknowledged. But they thought India's ancestors had something to contribute and they were one of the great civilizations of the past. And this, what the Orientalists did, is what Indian reformers in the 19th century used to justify their reform. They said, we may be in crisis now, we may have caste and other problems now, but we were great once. It gave Indians a cultural confidence, ironically, through this first generation of Englishmen. So in this conversation where everything British equal to bad, everything Indian equal to good, is complicated. On the nationalist side also, there's an essay on V.O. Chidambaram Pillai. And this is a time when, in the early 20th century, where Swadeshi meant you make khadi, you do a few charkhas, you make a few bangles and things like that. This man started a shipping company. He did the most ambitious thing as far as the Swadeshi movement went. The British completely destroyed him. On pretty much, you know, invented charges, they put him away in jail. When he emerges, he's lost everything. He's lost his friends, he's lost his money. Where he had a company that was valued at a lakh that they were offering to buy it from him, the shipping company. Suddenly he was a pauper. And the judge who finally gives him back his legal license, his name is Wallace. He names his son Walleshwaran because he's so indebted to this judge. So Chidambaram Pillai was one of those people in the national struggle who was forgotten, who sort of got left behind, because the freedom struggle had its own politics, it had its own egos, it had its own rivalries. There were people within who were sort of backstabbing each other even then. None of this was pristine and romantic. None of this was some sort of grand narrative as you read in our textbooks that everybody single-mindedly was fighting for one uniting cause, etc. It was there at some level, but all other human failings also marred the freedom struggle. So the essay on Gandhiji in the book, it's called What If Gandhiji Had Lived.
In fact, I was coming to that as the second last of today's discussion. So tell us what you have written about it.
Yeah, Gandhiji once in writing said that he wanted to live for 125 years, which meant he would have died around the time soon after the Babri Masjid thing. In the 90s is when he would have died. So this is a slightly mischievous, speculative essay, and historians normally don't go down the what if route, but I've just decided to throw myself into that and see what would have happened if he had lived. On the one hand, two things the essayist does is to look at how he would have dealt with various things that happened in India. For example, if during the emergency, if Indira Gandhi had declared the emergency and he decided, I'm going to go on a fast unto death, would Indira Gandhi have said, fine? You know, there's a possibility. Babri Masjid, would he have reacted to it? He expressed hopes a little before his death that he would go and live in Pakistan for the rest of his life. Would he have become an international headache for Jinnah or Nehru, both of them? But the other thing is also the fact that he died in the way he died, at the time he died, in some ways again made it possible for Nehru and the early generation of India's leaders to again garland him, put him as a photograph in every public office, and then conveniently forget about everything he said. Because he was not in favor of the dams and industrialization and any of that. He was not in favor of the kind of parliamentary democracy Nehru had in mind. So we see this because soon after his death, his ashes were taken in special trains to different parts of the country to scatter them in various rivers and holy spots, etc. What's interesting is that these special trains not only had the flag of the Indian Union, next to the flag they also had the flag of the Indian National Congress. Because the Congress was legitimizing itself as from being a nationalist movement to becoming the political force in India, in a sense through Gandhiji's ashes, as it were. And Gandhiji's death at that time, in many ways, got rid of what could have quickly escalated into another problem. If Gandhiji had said, no, Nehru was banning books already in the 1950s. In the Northeast, they already had almost obscene powers that were given to the army to do as they pleased in the Northeast. All of this would have upset Gandhiji, and he would have, publicly taken a stand. And would it, Anna Hazare had that movement in 2011, and the press went gaga and said, this is the coming of the new Gandhi, a new Messiah, and all of that. Where is he now? The world is forgotten. Because that's the other thing, right? All human societies, at the end of the day, masters of hypocrisy. When a person has purpose, that person has value. Afterwards, you become just this person, this cranky old man who's sitting and saying things. People also move on. So would Gandhiji have been reduced into a man writing op-eds about his bowel movements with nobody caring? Would that have been his fate? So the whole idea is partly to hold up a mirror to our own hypocrisy through that essay, but also to look at his own quirks and to wonder how he would have dealt with different aspects of post-independence India and how he would have managed in an India that changed around his eyes and which he no longer recognized.
So he had his value till he achieved what he went to achieve. After that,
he became a little bit of a liability in many ways. It's not fashionable to say it, but there's plenty of historical evidence to show that some of his statements, some of his positions were causing great discomfort to not just Nehru, but also Sardar Patel and so on. His experiments with, his various experiments, some of them are pretty controversial. They had objections to all of that. And they said, even if you're doing it, don't write op-eds about it. Don't scandalize the whole country by saying all this, because you may have a certain thing in mind, but it's not proper. So there are questions there. But
before we open up to the public for their questions, do you want to say what you said in your last essay?
in my last essay.
The essay for our times.
Yes.
That's probably the longest essay in the book. Which is the only essay that, I mean, everything else is historical. That one essay is sort of tailored to conversations that are happening in our own time. And it begins with the first meeting of the Congress Party in the mid-1880s. And I've looked at the original circular that was sent out. And it's interesting that the circular says that delegates from all parts of the country are welcome, but everybody must speak English. Because it makes sense, right? Even with Gandhiji, I gave the analogy to the kids here earlier. Gandhiji was born in Gujarat, Gujarati speaking. Nehru was a Kashmiri who was raised in Allahabad, Hindi speaker. Rajgopalachari was from Madras, speaking Tamil. Bose was a Bengali. The only common link language these guys had was English. And in that 1885 meeting, even in all the subsequent meetings, knowing English was an integral part of being a member of the Congress Party. Because English in some ways was the unifying feature for these elites from different parts of the country. And there was a report soon after the first meeting of the Indian National Congress in the Bombay Gazette. And the journalist in the Bombay Gazette has a very interesting way of describing it. He says that there were Pathans from the northwest who came in their, you know, flowing Pathan kurtas or whatever. There were people from the south in their lungis with their, you know, torsos bare, just wearing shawls. There were people who dressed, Bengalis who dressed impeccably in western clothes. And there were people who didn't even wear footwear. There were all kinds of hairstyles, all kinds of turbans. And he gives a full list of how the Puneri turban is better than the Parsi turban and so on. And he says that the only place you would see such a diversity of costumes and colors and races and cuisines and castes is at a fancy dress ball. Because that first Indian National Congress meeting did in some ways to this reporter resemble a fancy dress ball. Till then, nobody had thought these people would come together and have or express anything in common. You look at there's an essay on the history of Indian football, and there's another book I'm reading on the history of Indian cricket. All these clubs, the difficulty took about 15 years to put together the first Indian cricket team in the early 20th century. Because for 15 years, people were fighting about how many Parsis, how many Muslims, how many Hindus, how many upper castes, how many Dalits, things like that. Because there was no pan-Indian notion of Indian at that time. It was still about community. These were the things that sort of gave people a sense of meaning. So Gandhi and Nehru and one generation or one set of freedom fighters, they decided this diversity can become a liability, but we can also use it to our advantage. Which is that what they call a Nehruvian consensus. We build a consensus that no matter what language you speak, what clothes you wear, what food you eat, what color your skin is, you are all Indian. If you live in this country, you all have a place. But then there was another one that comes up with Savarkar, for example. And Savarkar, I know, ironically, as late as 1909, he's a big champion of Hindu-Muslim unity, etc. The theory is that when he was imprisoned for over a decade, his jailer was a Muslim, and apparently a lot of his vendetta comes from the ill treatment he got there in jail. He of course transforms himself and his ideology, and he comes up with the notion that you need to have your Matrabhumi but also your Punya Bhumi here. Merely staying here is not enough. Your holy land has to be here. Only then are you fully an Indian in that sense. For him, Hinduness was the deciding factor. But the thing is, Hinduness is a very tricky territory. Because Savarkar said that the Nayars wept at the fate of the Kashmiri Pandits, but the fact was the Nayars had no clue what the Kashmiri Pandits were doing, because they were too far away, far too separated from anything in you know, they had nothing in common. You look at the Kerala and Tamil Nadu, there's only a bunch of hills, the Western Ghats separating these two territories. There are passes and there's plenty of contract and trade. The Tamil Brahmin will wear his kudumi or the tuft of hair at the back, the Malayali Brahmin will wear it in front. The Tamil Brahmin woman will wear colourful saris, the Malayali Brahmin woman will wear only white. In white in Tamil Nadu is the colour of widowhood. In Kerala, you go to your wedding mandap wearing white in those days. In Tamil Nadu, you cover yourself. In Kerala, everybody's walking around topless. In territories that are just next to each other, there's that kind of diversity. Within Kerala, extreme North Malabar people will not marry from South Malabar. South Malabar will not marry from Cochin. Cochin will not marry from further south, because their identities were extremely localized. So the notion of diversity as a sort of unifying factor, seeing it not as a liability, but saying, fine, we're diverse, so what? Move on. That was at that time a more constructive way of pulling the country together rather than a racial concept, because to begin with, there was caste. You know, Phule, Ambedkar always dressed in a suit, because his point was to Gandhiji. Gandhiji had the privilege to discard the suit and wear a loincloth. Ambedkar's ancestors were never allowed to wear anything but the loincloth. So wearing a suit for him was a mark of empowerment. Just as Mayavati has statues of herself holding bags in her hand, these handbags, people laugh at it as comical, but she's making a statement. She's saying that I'm a Dalit woman holding an expensive handbag. That's a statement she's trying to make, enshrining herself like that in statues. Of course, there is a little bit of self-promotion, but there's also a statement that's being made. So I'm essentially in that final essay looking at these two ideologies and looking at history and saying that you know, there are certain sleeping dogs, let them lie. You know, why do you want to resurrect issues and create a homogenous country, a homogenous system, a homogenous language, a homogenous way of life, a homogenous food, a homogenous culture? You know, none of this is going to work. If you start looking for a majority community, that majority is made up of very many minorities. And my ex-boss Shashi Tharoor often said that everybody in India is actually a minority. It's the British census that starts counting people and giving people a sense of, oh, this is that much and this number is higher than that number. But till then, Indians didn't have such preoccupations. And our preoccupation with majority minority is a mark of insecurity. It's a mark of still not having figured out who we are. And that there's no need to be in that position. The British drew our political maps. So what? Good. But the political maps is what it is now. I don't think my patriotism is questioned because the British created it. It's fine. They created the map. Fine. So it was. Histories are full of episodes like this. You know, the English language united India's earliest nationalists. Good for them. You know, why does it have to cause us such angst and insecurity? And why must we look for this pristine tradition as though tradition is a rock that you put on a pedestal and worship all day long? Whereas in fact, tradition and culture are evolving. They're organic things. You give to the world and you take from the world. The Peshwas I referred to, they're Orthodox Brahmins ruling in Pune. But you look at that's the other point I make in the book. These were human beings. They were not gods. You look at the records of the police records of the Peshwas, and it's fascinating. There's murder. There's caste rules being flouted. There's, you know, a lot of adultery and all of that. There's this one case where a woman tries to murder her husband by crushing glass into the atta and feeding him these murderous chapatis. This is happening in the late 18th century. There's this other time where a man tries to sexually assault his daughter-in-law, and his defense, when he's apprehended, she files a complaint, and his defense is, oh no, I was on the way to the bathroom and I tripped. Now the funny thing is, a few years ago in London, there was a Saudi diplomat who tried to sexually assault somebody, and his defense was the exact same thing. I was on the way to the bathroom and I tripped. And I read this thing in the 18th century records and I thought, wow, like there's a Saudi man saying that in 2011 or 12, and here I am in the late 18th century reading the exact same excuse for sexual assault in the Peshwa era. Because they dealt with the same problems, they dealt with the same ironies and contradictions we do today. The difference is, for them, they had the cultural confidence to deal with it, and not everything was not some test of nationalism, everything was not some test of your loyalty, everything was not a test of how traditional and how you know, faithful you are to your culture and all of that. As I said, that Maratha prince lampooning the caste system is merely one of many such examples in Telugu literature alone. You look at earlier literature and God is presented not as some distant figure that you're supposed to worship. God is shown often in a lot of Telugu poetry as a customer on his way to his favorite courtesan. And the courtesan slams the door in his face saying, I saw you with that Radha the other day, why don't you go back to her? I don't want to see your face. These are the kind of things, these are the dialogues that are, because it's a very personal relationship. In the 18th century, one of the courtesans in the book is Muddupalmi, who writes erotica or sensuous poetry in the 18th century. And it's interesting because the focus is Radha. And Radha is first very jealous that Krishna has married her niece Ila. And the poem is about how Krishna eventually appeases Radha. And at one point, Krishna complains that even when I tell her I'm tired, she insists on jumping on my bed and beginning the game of love. Because Radha has physical demands and needs that she wants satisfied. This physicality of women was so... In the 18th century, it was fine. Muddupalmi was a gem in the court of the Tanjore Maharaja. But by the 19th century, this Victorian infection in our heads had affected us so much that some people who read her poetry, they pretended her name was actually Manu Pillai, because they were happy with a man talking about things like desire and physicality. They couldn't quite absorb the idea that a woman was talking about desire and physicality. Then later, when Bangalore Nanga Nagaratnama published her poem, the book was banned till after independence, because we absorbed a lot of what we often think is traditional Indian culture. It's not traditional Indian culture, it's Victorian. It was the British who gave us a sense of guilt, and we're still dealing with that guilt. Whereas if you look in the right context at various episodes in Indian history, you find that our ancestors were much more interesting than that. They were much more confident, much more capable. They had a sense of humor, they had their flaws, they had their weaknesses, and it didn't make them lesser human beings for that. If you expect them to be superhuman gods, yeah, you're going to be disappointed. But if you acknowledge that they are human beings, it doesn't take away their greatness. When I was working on my first book, I discovered an 1870s letter by this man called Kerala Varma. Kerala Varma is today venerated as the Kalidas of Kerala because he's a great Sanskrit scholar. And he's also called the father of Malayalam literature. So, you know, he's got this wonderful place. He's enshrined nicely in Kerala history. In the 1870s, however, in a letter, he basically talks about how he's interested in marijuana and bhang. And I think that, you know, today kids, 20-year-old kids all across the country are all smoking weed and having their bhang or whatever. Marijuana is pretty much easily available anywhere in the country. And this is the father of Malayalam literature doing the same thing in his 20s, a century before. Does that make him a lesser, does that somehow taint his achievements? It doesn't. It was fine. He was a 20-something-year-old man doing what 20-year-olds do then, just as 20-year-olds do now. The job of a historian is not to sit in judgment on people in the past. The job is not to make a value judgment. You know, I sort of horrified the kids today here by telling them how much violence there was in Indian history. Till the 1870s, the British who claimed to be civilizing India, they were blowing people out of cannons. And their justification was that blowing a person out of a cannon is a very merciful method of killing, because the person dies before they realize what's happening to them. But for the onlooker, the sight of chunks of flesh flying all over the countryside is so horrifying, they'll never stand up in rebellion against the state. But they weren't the first. The Peshwas and the Marathas did that. In the Arthashastra, you know, the king's wife commits adultery with somebody, the man is supposed to be cooked alive in a jar. That's the method suggested. There's this great man who stood up to the British in 1809 in Kerala called Velu Thambi Dalava. His favorite way of executing people was to tie one leg to one elephant, the other leg to the other elephant, and to rip the person apart. Because violence had to be done publicly. There were no institutions then. You had to demonstrate your capacity for violence anytime there was a threat to your power, because otherwise power could go away very quickly. So when my second book on the Deccan Sultans came out, there's a very senior figure on Twitter said, oh, you're whitewashing a tyrant, this Ibrahim Adil Shah II, a very interesting man. He called himself, he was a Sunni Muslim, venerated Saraswati, called himself son of Saraswati and Ganapati, was a great speaker of the Marathi language, a very interesting, colorful man. He said, you're whitewashing him because he, you know, blinded his regent and murdered his brother. I said, but who wasn't doing this? There's a Vijayanagara emperor who murdered his father. Devaraya II, one of the greatest Vijayanagara emperors, had a coup either by a cousin or a nephew. It's not clear the exact relationship, but a close family member. What did they do? They had to publicly make a statement. Otherwise, factions and court would go to the person they spared. Being merciful was considered weakness. You had to show yourself constantly as powerful and strong, for which violence was integral. So the notion that our ancestors were all thinking pious thoughts all day long and thinking of ahimsa all day long is a fallacy. In reality, Indian history has violence, it has a humor, it has all the extremes. Because at the end of the day, we are human beings. And the one thing you can count on is human stupidity, because human beings will keep repeating the mistakes of the past. Why do all great empires eventually fall? Because the mistakes are all the same. Empires fall for the same reason. Nothing is eternal. Kings back in the day liked giving grants, saying this grant will survive as long as the sun and the moon endure. But they themselves didn't live that long. Their empires all fell. Because that is what human beings are about. And if you look at history, acknowledge that historical figures are human beings, we'll stop making value judgments and give raw material to politicians to pervert and sort of misread and deliberately cause trouble.
That's a brilliant statement to close this by. Thank you so much, Manu.
Thank you.
This is absolutely first class. Friends, none of the stories that I read in the book are those which we knew about. He has discovered and written about some absolutely fascinating things. And all characters which are not, you know, as well known as to us as they are have found a story in the book. Thank you so much, Manu.
Thank you for having me.
I'm abusing power. I'll ask a few questions. First question is that as I noticed, chronicling history is a challenge in this country. And we have Greek sources, Chinese sources, Islamic sources, and they have habit of writing diaries and hagiography, autobiography. But Indians have this strong tradition, oral tradition, and culture of memory. Do you see any difficulty in your work because of this?
There is a lot that's lost to us now. For example, there is something called the Mapla Ramayana, which is a Muslim version of the Ramayana that exists in Kerala. There were folk singers who went around. And nobody tried to codify this till the 1960s or 70s. The result is most of this Muslim Ramayana has lost. And it's fascinating Ramayana because Ravan is the Sultan in it, not a Hindu king over there. Shurpanakha, when she propositions Ram and Ram says, sorry, I'm already married. She says, that's fine. The Sharia says if you take a second wife, she quotes the Sharia to Ram in her proposal to Ram. There is such a Ramayana in Kerala. Nobody codified it. Similarly, you know, this king of Travancore, the hero of Kerala history called Manthan. There's a long state narrative of him. There's lots of poetry, lots of records that support that state narrative. But it was only in the 70s and 80s that they codified something called Villapat.
Villapat is basically folk songs that are sung in southern Travancore, in Dhanjanad. And these are folk singers who, from the 18th century, had a counter narrative where the king is the villain. And you know, the people he defeated are the true heroes of the story. Is this on? So, you know, that counter-narrative always existed. From the 18th century when he was alive, down till our own times, the counter-narrative existed. The question is, when was it codified? That in that, a lot of information has been lost. A lot of leaders and stories of lower castes have been lost because nobody's bothered to codify these. Nobody's bothered to put these down in books. Nobody's bothered to create records on these things. So when a historian today looks at, the further back you go in time, the more you look at history, to look not just at the records, not just at the hagiographies, not just at the biographies and the poetry, to look at architecture, you have to look at folklore, you have to look at the history of the common people on the ground, their songs, their traditions, because most of it has already disappeared. But if you're not looking, you're only getting a partial impression of what Indian history is.
The other question I have taken from your very, very powerful afterword, which you had, is that India, I can see something even as late as the 18th century, from still the Hagar, you would see an Abyssinian, the Navy Guard in this town, the Abyssinian Constabulary Guard. And obviously, they had free access to come to Hyderabad to protect the Nizam.
Yeah.
You see Italians here on trade. You see Venetian merchants here on the way. They were actually discounting bills to be paid after 180 days. So this is a strong tradition. Where did we lose it? You think the British are cause for that?
It, you know, a lot of it comes from sort of this holier-than-thou thing around the nationalist struggle. I mean, it was an important struggle, but it was not the beginning and ending of Indian history. The way textbooks are structured, it's almost as if everything is leading to this grand destiny of the freedom struggle and to Indian independence. But this is something we've ascribed retrospectively. I always make the argument that we call different times of different periods in history the golden age, etc. People at that time didn't wake up in the morning thinking, ah, this is a golden age. We ascribe such values to that. They were going about their business with a great amount of confidence. That is why we call it a golden age. So, you know, a lot... Wait, what was the question again?
There's a teeming diverse culture into India.
So the notion of the foreigner in India is actually not, it was a nationalist struggle that somehow makes it about us versus them. Otherwise, the foreigner was a constant presence. The kids, I was telling them an example privately afterwards, a bunch of them today, about how in the 7th century, the Pallava emperor in Kanchipuram died and they didn't have heirs. So what do the Brahmins do? They look up the family tree and they find that a few generations before, a Pallava prince had got on a ship, left court and ended up marrying some Cambodian or Vietnamese lady. So they send a group of Brahmins, so much for Kalapani, those Brahmins get on a ship, go all the way to Cambodia or Vietnam, exact country is not clear. They find a 12-year-old descendant of that Pallava and they bring him back. This is a boy with Southeast Asian features who's brought and installed in Kanchipuram as the next Pallava emperor and assumes the name Nandivarman II or something like that. So when people say the Mughals are foreigners because they came from outside, does that mean all the Pallavas who followed were foreigners because their ancestor came from Southeast Asia? This notion of foreign is a very new one. Otherwise, people are always coming in. You know, you look at St. Thomas, the stories he came to Kerala in 52 AD. Even if he didn't personally come, the fact is Christians have been there longer than Christianity reached Europe. So long before Europeans became Christians, they were already there. Islam similarly, the founding political legend of Kerala features a king called Cheraman Perumal. And Cheraman Perumal witnesses the prophet splitting the moon and he wants to convert to Islam and go off to Mecca. And all the royal families in Kerala claim legitimacy because they say Cheraman Perumal, before he left, divided his kingdom and gave us this territory. So he's the founding political legend of Kerala, but he's immediately connected to Muslims and to Arabia. Because the fact is, culturally, Kerala had more in common with Arabia than it had with North India. Delhi had more in common with Kabul than it had with South India. Now we have these boundaries and we want to retrospectively make it look like this was always the case. But in reality, it was a different culture. The South as a peninsula, as a trading society, has always had foreigners coming in. The Africans, you know, they weren't, the Nizams, they came in as bodyguards and so on. But in a place called Jaunpur in Uttar Pradesh, there was a brief African dynasty that was in power. How many people in Uttar Pradesh realized there were Africans in power in Uttar Pradesh in the 14th century? In the 15th century, for about a decade in Bengal, there was a Habshi dynasty or an Abyssinian or an Ethiopian family that was in power for about 10-15 years in Bengal. How many Bengalis know that? Razia Sultan was partly murdered because she was close to an Abyssinian. In Ahmednagar, the Nizam Shahs, now look at it, the Nizam Shahs are descended from converted Brahmins. They are Shia Muslims, so they send their bodies to be buried, except for one, they send their bodies to be buried in Persia. They not only took Persian wives, but they also took at least two sultans married African women. Ahmednagar today is a tier 2 town in Maharashtra, and I grew up in Maharashtra. We never had a notion that a few centuries ago there were black begums in Ahmednagar, but they exist, and there are miniature paintings of these princes and noblemen who had black skin. and all of them married local people, so it's very likely that the, you know, the their blood exists in lots of people in this country. And it's not very surprising. As late, so you know, the Mughal emperor is toppled after the Great Rebellion. He's put on a bullock cart and sent off to Burma. A few decades later, when the British topple the Burmese king, he's put on a bullock cart, taken to a port and shipped off to India, where he finally lands up in Ratnagiri. So the last king of Burma is in Ratnagiri. His daughters, they're all lonely, they're not allowed to have friends, they're not allowed to go out. They're just stuck in this house arrest situation. His oldest daughter commences an affair with the watchman, who's a Maharashtrian called Savant. And she has a love child with this man called Tutu. And she later changes her name to Baisubai, marries a Maratha called Pawar, who's a bus driver. And her descendants live in Ratnagiri. You look at them, they look like any other Maharashtrian. But they're actually descendants of the last king of Burma. Because that marriage, intermarriage over two generations very quickly wipes out any physical traces of foreignness. But the fact is, we all have that element of foreign blood. The Arabs came to, people think that Islam came to India with the sword raised in Sindh and so on. The fact is, in the lifetime of the Prophet, the first mosque was built in Kerala. Now, right-wing people on Twitter will say, but there's no evidence to show that that building is that old. Fine, but two centuries later, by the mid-800s, you have a royal grant of a Hindu king, and the witnesses are Muslims. The signatures of witnesses are Arabic. So if the Muslims are already powerful enough to be witnessing royal grants and signing in Arabic, they've been there a while, they've already created a certain influence in that region, because it's been there from the beginning. And it's not surprising that, you know, seafaring between Arabia and Kerala was pretty easy. And these people came. As soon as Islam was created, it came to Kerala as well. But this we rarely learn, because we like linear narratives. We like one simplified answer for a country that is full of layers and complexity and complication. And know what is true of Hinduism in Kashmir is not the Hinduism in Bhopal. It's not the Hinduism in Kerala. It's not the Hinduism in Pondicherry. Everything is touched in different ways. Everything has evolved in different ways. But we sometimes get insecure acknowledging that. And that's why we go after these linear narratives where the foreigner is this one category outside. And we like to deny any foreignness for ourselves.
I like the idea of saying concept of foreigners who really take an idea. How people may know here that one of the Brahmin saw a beggar on the road from Delhi when he went there and brought him to Hyderabad, brought him to where he was. And he asked him who he was, and he said he was the grandson of Shah of Iran, and he was banned from that city. And they gave him a perspective of one of them.
There's lots of this actually. When the Safavids fell, there's a writer called Rana Safvi. Safvi is actually the old Safavid title, their surname. Her husband's family, they all fled from Persia when the dynasty fell. Where did they run to? They came to India. When the Parsis, you know, they came to India when they were persecuted. The Jews, when St. Thomas came and got off Kerala, the legend goes to the first thing he saw was a flute-playing Jewish girl. Because the Jews had already come to Kerala by then. And I remember this anecdote Shashi Tharoor told me of how he went to meet a father's friend, in a Jewish man in London, when he was on his way to his studies in America. He had a halt in London. And he said that he goes there, and this is a man with very pale skin, dressed in a three-piece suit, etc. But he opens his mouth and starts talking in pure Malayalam, because the man was a Cochin Jew, whose family has been there for centuries and centuries. And they were pure, you know, Malayalam speakers. They had no issues with the language. So the notion that an outsider is somehow evil. The Adil Shahis of Bijapur, you know, this is Yusuf Adil Shah. Nobody knows exactly where he came from. It was somewhere in Persia, some say as far as Georgia. On the ship, he decides that he's going to start pretending he's the long-lost emperor, long-lost son of the Ottoman emperor. So by the time he lands, he's invented royal antecedents for himself. But he marries a Maratha woman. So the Adil Shahi dynasty from day one is part Persian, part Marathi. And that Maratha woman wasn't merely a, you know, womb to produce children. Two generations later, when one of her legitimate grandsons proved to be not up to the mark, she had no issues blinding him, putting him in a dungeon, and replacing him with an illegitimate grandson. She was a woman with political clout. So the Adil Shahi court from the beginning was a mixed court, where they were Shia, some kings were Sunni, some were Shia, some were worshipping Saraswati, Ganapati, things like that. It was much more mixed up, because that they had that space to do it. People often position the fall of Vijayanagar in 1565 as the destruction of a Hindu empire by a bunch of Muslim kings. If you look at it at face value or superficially, it looks like that. A Hindu king, an emperor, defeated by four major Muslim sultans. But look, scratch under the surface and the story gets complicated. The emperor, the de facto emperor of Vijayanagar at the time, Raya Raya, began his career working as a nobleman of the Qutub Shah of Golconda. When he married Krishnadevaraya's daughters, when he moved to Vijayanagar, he was originally an employee of a sultan. The Qutub Shah, who was at the battle, had lived 7 years in exile in Vijayanagar when his brother was trying to kill him. He fled not to a Muslim state, he came to Vijayanagar. He was a great patron of the Telugu language, and Teluguized his name from Ibrahim to Abhirama and Malik Brahma, because he wanted to sort of Teluguize himself. He married a Telugu woman, patronized poetry on the Mahabharata. The Adil Shah who was present at the battle fighting Vijayanagar was the adopted son of the Vijayanagar emperor. And the Nizam Shah who was present, as I said, was descended from Brahmins. There were 6,000 Marathas fighting in the Battle of Talikota where Vijayanagar fell, but they were fighting for the Sultans. There was a celebrated general called Ainul-Mul Gilani. He was fighting for the Vijayanagar emperor. And now, of course, they've invented this story, and nobody, I don't know where it's come from, where they say Ainul-Mul Gilani in the last moment switched teams and went over to the Sultan, yes. That's how Vijayanagar fell. There is no record of this. Nothing. It's just existed in some books. Nobody knows. There's no footnote telling you where the story's come from. Nobody's got a source for the story. The only inscriptional source on Ainul-Mul Gilani has him donating land to 80 Brahmins. That's the only actual record of this man. So it is, dig under one layer under the surface, it's very complicated. Then they'll say that, you know, all these sultans came and they took over Hindu territories. They lived in urban nodes, in a few urban sections and centers where they had power, and they certainly did. Their ideology was Islamic, their state language was expressed in Islamic terms, etc. But they were not persecuting people en masse. So in Hyderabad, there was this Gadwal Raj, one of the Samastha states under the Nizam of Hyderabad. They existed as feudatories of the Kakatiyas. And the Kakatiyas were displaced, pushed out by the Delhi Sultans, they became vassals of the Delhi Sultans. Then the Bahmanis came, became vassals of the Bahmanis. Then the Qutub Shahs came, they became vassals of the Qutub Shah. Nizam of Hyderabad comes, they become vassals of the Nizam. So from the Kakatiya period till 1948, when the Nizam's kingdom was finally conquered and annexed by India, this Hindu dynasty was ruling over that 1,000 square mile of territory. If you look at the map simplistically, you say, oh, all of this is conquered by the Nizam. But it's concentric layers of power. Alliances under that were shifting constantly. There were no fixed boundaries. If your village had been at a boundary place, tomorrow starts paying taxes to the other ruler, that village belongs to the other ruler. There are no walls, there are no fixed boundaries. How many noblemen you have determines your power. And these are constantly shifting. Noblemen, look at the Marathas, you know, at one point, Shivaji's mother's family served the Mughals because they preferred pitching their flag with the Mughals. A lot of Maratha families when Shivaji started out didn't see him as an equal. They said, you're one of us, how can you suddenly pretend to be some sort of great king or whatever, we don't recognize you. They preferred various sultans. His own father was a loyal servant of the Nizam Shahs and then the Adil Shahs and so on. So, you know, there is that complication there, which is not to say that religion had no place, which is not to say bigotry didn't exist. There was bigotry. People's self-identity was expressed in religious terms. So Vijayanagar called themselves Hinduraya Suratrana, which is sultans among Hindu kings. On the one hand, they were calling themselves consciously Hindu, but they were also appropriating the word sultan for themselves. They were saying, you are Muslim sultans, we are Hindu sultans. That sultan came to have meaning for themselves. The bronze of Krishnadevaraya that exists in the great temple in Tirupati is wearing a Turkish hat, because people in Vijayanagar were fascinated with Turkish sartorial tastes and fashions, and they were borrowing soft power, as we call it today, from Persia. You know, Muslim Firoz Shah Bahmani, when he married a Vijayanagar princess, he said, I don't want just the regular dowry, I want 2,000 artists and professionals and creative people to come here and sort of enrich my court. Because he deliberately wanted to import that architecture, he wanted to deliberately import Hindu elements into his state. So there was give and take. The question is, what are we going to highlight? You know, if you want to look at the bigots and fight imagined grievances today, in today's time, and, you know, decide to squabble all your energy doing that, good for you. But in reality, those people lived and they didn't really have these many issues. We are the ones who now ascribe such values to that.
One last question. I think history has been very unfair to South Indian history. And when we read your Rebel Sultan, we find that this is something which we should have known. Oh, obvious.
Yeah.
But in schools and colleges, our history is not Indian history. Is it a fair comment to make?
It's partly politics, because where power resides is what determines who writes the textbooks and how they write them. And it's one of the things about the national struggle. As I said, most of the dramatic action was taking place in North India, not so much in the South. So when you're
obsessing with the nationalist movement as though this is what defines the country, you end up giving the short end of the stick to the South, because the South was asking rather inconvenient questions at the time. So you don't want to discuss that, so you focus on the North. But the other thing is also, the North, as I said, this whole question of Islam, for example, we've decided that Islam came because invaders brought it to the country. So you don't want to highlight the fact that long before that it came through peaceful embassies of commerce. The South has always in that sense got, to use an Indianism, a stepmotherly treatment from history. But, you know, that is changing. The more you know of, new storytellers are coming, new people are highlighting the South, and the stories exist. The question is merely learning to look in the right places.
Good. You made a comment somewhere saying that Varanasi is a bit speaking about the place where you are speaking. All of us are waiting for the day when it will be renamed as Bhagyanagar. And you have already started a bit. How far you have had a research to say it is a bit?
So the thing is, if you look at the inscriptional evidence, if you look at the Sultan who creates the city, for example, Muhammad Kuli Kutista, he himself has written something called the Kuliya. He refers, he actually lists his favorite courtesans, his favorite wives, and his favorite women in the Kuliya, but he doesn't mention anybody called that.
Because if you look at the earliest reference to the city being named after a courtesan, it's from a Mughal who actually talks that this new city is named after a hardened war, the king, this Qutub Shah named it after a courtesan and things like that, almost as an insult. Because they were a little taken aback by the splendor and glory of this new city he was building, by the ambition. And remember, these are Mughals who never even acknowledged the Qutub Shahs as independent rulers. They always called them Qutub al-Mulk, because they said that, you know, we're not going to acknowledge you as sultans and as our equals. So they had to play down what the sultan was achieving and what he was doing. So they invent this rumor, as to quote, I think, Mr. Sherwani, he talks about how a little whisper turned into chapters, chapters turned into books, it turned into a legend, and now everybody believes it. Whereas inscription, the sultan's own records and writings, they don't actually talk about anybody called Bhagmati. They list all his other lovers, but they don't talk about this one lady after whom he apparently named the city. Sorry,
sir. Thanks, Manu. The thing is, thanks a lot for doing this original research that you have been doing over the past 3 years. But I got to learn about you through your Sunday articles in the Mint, which actually made me think it's a pretty good paper. Brilliant work. My question to you, there's one single question that I want to leave the answer on is, what helped you unlearn all the history that you learned and actually come to this actual research in reality?
It was when I was working on my first book. Because when I was working on my first book, you know, I was investigating the matrilineal system in Kerala. And the matrilineal system is a fascinating setup. So I was dealing with the story of the Maharani of Travancore. Now, to give you a brief encapsulation of the matrilineal system, the Maharani's husband is not the Maharaja. He's only called the consort. The consort is not allowed to call his wife by name. He has to call his wife Your Highness. He's not allowed to visit the royal bedchamber without her permission. Sharing a bedroom was a scandal, if unheard of. It didn't happen till the 1930s, sharing a bedroom with your husband, because her husband was a subject. Every time the Maharani of Travancore went out for a drive, the husband had to follow in a smaller car, because he couldn't sit in the same limo as her, because if he sat next to her, it signified equality. At feasts in the palace, the Maharani had 4 varieties of dessert, her husband was served 2. And she often got a 21-gun salute every time she entered and left the city. Her husband merely got a rifle salute every time he entered and left the gate. You never know about this, but this was the matrilineal system I was investigating, and most of the material I was reading was written by men who were saying the matrilineal system was created so Brahmin men could have access to lower caste women and so on and so forth. And that was interesting, I was almost buying into that. And then I came across three feminist scholars, J. Devika, Sharada Mani and G. Aronima. And reading that feminist perspective on the matrilineal system, where the women's benefits in this are highlighted, where the fact that women had autonomy became the main thrust rather than the byproduct, that opened my eyes and I realized, hold on, you look at anything in Indian history from a feminist perspective, it's a completely different angle. So it's a very good way to start learning. Always ask the question, where are the women? That itself will upset a lot of these established narratives, because they're all as narratives established by men. So if you ask that basic question of where are the women, slowly the pieces start breaking up, cracks start appearing. And once a crack has appeared, you can drive a wedge in and slowly start investigating in a more sustained fashion. So yeah, I just realized, so long as you're not making a value judgment, your mind is open. At the end of the day though, all historians have their biases. Anybody telling you they're writing objective history is lying, because objectivity is what you're aspiring to. Now my filters, I may have got rid of 3 filters, but somewhere in my mind there's a filter. You tell a Victorian historian about the feminist perspective, he would not even have understood it. Today there's LGBT perspectives that are coming up, which in 100 years from now, it may revise what we are doing. Very quickly, this book I've written may get outdated in 25 years, because new perspectives, new angles, and new dimensions of looking at this may come to light. So you have to always be aware that at some level, 5% of your bias will come in, and what you're doing is not perfect. As more material comes to the fore, as new angles come to the fore, history will be revised. And knowing that keeps your mind open, you know how to look at history without getting yourself taken too seriously and thinking that you're doing some groundbreaking work, because frankly, you're not. Tomorrow, someone's going to come and do better work. So that gives you a sense of perspective.
Absolutely fascinating talk. I got a little bit of history, just a little bit, because I could read off the names of the Mughal emperors, but I missed the rest. But now I know that Aryan even skimmed the surface. There is so much, a wealth of information.
Start with reciting the names of Mughal emperors. It's equally interesting.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. And then, my question then is, how important do you think the teaching of history is? I ask this question because I see this discipline totally vanishing now. So should the government be investing a little more into the history department? I also ask this question because today you see, you know, people rewriting history there any which way they want. People who you think are very knowledgeable, talking absolute nonsense. Even a person like Naipaul comes and makes some absurd, statements about Hindu temples being, raised by Muslim Arabs. So in a way, justifying Babri demolition. So how important do you think teaching of the
on this temple thing first, as a history
review. Temples were demolished, but what's interesting is these were not blanket demolitions. An invading army didn't demolish every temple they saw. Temples were demolished when they were connected to the legitimacy of your enemy king. So Tipu Sultan, now some people who are ultra leftists believe that Tipu Sultan patronized a lot of temples, he gave donations to mutts and this and that. And others will say, no, but in Kerala he demolished temples, he converted people forcefully. But the point is, it's not either or, it's both. In one context, he's an invader. An invader is going to break your social order. An invader is going to break existing social networks there. When Tipu entered Kerala, he said, I'm going to tie my horse on the flagstaff of the Padmanabhaswamy temple of the Maharaja of Travancore. He didn't name every temple. Padmanabhaswamy is linked to the Maharaja's legitimacy because the Maharaja rules as Padmanabhadasa. That temple he will attack. He spared the Guruvayur temple because his ally, the Kochi Raja, was there. But other temples which were connected to his enemy's legitimacy, those were fair targets. And you find that Vijayanagar also. They would, every time Ramaraya went into Bijapur, for example, he destroyed the mosques there. Not every mosque he saw, but the mosque that the king had built. Because there was a statement he was trying to make there. In terms of why we must learn history, expecting governments to do it is a very bad idea, unless they put in the money and they disappear and let the history department decide how to use the money. Because the more power you give to governments, the worse the idea is. Because government is run by politicians. And I'm not even blaming them. If you're a politician, you're always going to look for raw material for your ideology, and the best supermarket for that is history. You go pick and choose a few things and you've justified your ideology. Their legitimacy comes from that. So politicians are always going to misread history. Trying to expect them to do better is, I think, a futile task. But should we know history? We should. Because if, to again quote my ex-boss, if you don't know where you've come from, how will you know where you're going? Now you have a platform that's created. If you don't understand what the foundations are, you have no idea about the health of the foundations, you have no idea what you're standing on, whether it's going to collapse or whether it's going to survive, because you need to know where and how and when this was done. And this is on personal level for me, for example, knowing my history is very important. My mother's story is different. She comes from relative comfort, but my father's father was an illiterate farmer in Kerala. This in a 99% literate state, he was an Angutacha, my grandfather. My father, after he passed away, one of my father's cousins told me how they had a shop. And, newspapers would come, these goods would come wrapped in newspapers. My father used to go flatten those out to read that. Now people say, you've written 3 books before 30, but that's because I know my father had to read a newspaper that was discarded packaging paper. That's where he came from, and that's where I know where I come from. Similarly, for any society, you need to know where your society came from. You need to know where your cultures come from. You need to also know where your weaknesses come from. Otherwise, what future are we building? I mean, we're building a future of ugly buildings and plastic, certainly. But in our heads, what are we really cultivating for tomorrow? To understand what we're creating, and to understand our sense of responsibility. One of the reasons I highlight violence in ancient India, and even till the 19th century, is because we now take all this for granted. We complain at the drop of a hat, but we don't realize that till 100 years ago, none of these freedoms existed. None of these, this sort of peace, this sort of movement, this sort of ease of living your life, none of this existed. If you don't understand that, how are you going to value this? We have now, everybody, when people fight on Twitter, day in, day out, there's outrage factories on Twitter and on social media. And you realize that, this voice is a very special thing. We only managed to wrest it from the British 70 years ago. Even today, everybody doesn't have a voice. So when you have a voice, squandering it on, at the drop of a hat, having an outrage about everything and anything, it's a waste. Use your voice responsibly. Use your voice where it matters, but not casually for anything and everything, for self-virtue signaling or self-promotion and that sort of thing. So if you don't know the past, if you don't know what sacrifices were made in the past, how are you going to value your present and what are you going to leave for the future? So history is essential for that reason also.
Okay, interesting slides. History, interesting slides.
you spoke about Basavaraj and the I was trying to understand Hindus in the post-British world, and since so much trust in, for example, the festival going on in this month right now, it seems to have very little to do with Vedic Hinduism, etc. So what is your thought on
Romila Thapar, there's something she calls syndicated Hinduism, which is an attempt at a homogenized Hinduism, which only really starts forming in the post-Victorian era. That is when we've decided that this country is now one block, we're all going to agitate as one people, which means we need to have one common cultural, some thread that runs through everybody. So today's Hinduism is not medieval Hinduism. Medieval Hinduism had very little to do with the time when Hinduism was in decline and Buddhism was the main religion here. And that Hinduism is, Adi Shankaracharya's Hinduism has nothing to do with Vedic Hinduism. Even the gods go in and out of fashion. So the Vedic era, you're worshipping Indra and Agni and Varuna. Where are they now? They don't exist now. Now it's Shiva, Vishnu, the triumvirate. They're the ones. The Trinity is what you worship now, for example. So different periods, for different historical reasons, different gods become popular. You look at even the concept of idol worship. If you read the Rig Veda, it talks about smashing the idols, you know, defeat the idol worshippers and all of that. That is what the Rig Veda talks about, where idol worship and phallus worshipping is considered negative. But by the time you come to the Atharva Veda, it's become normal. So the way you interpret that is usually that this was an ideology that existed, it made its peace with an existing ideology that was here. It managed to move on, it mutated into something that combines these two and it formed a new shape. And that is what Hinduism was. It was constantly changing shape. It was again not a rock that was constant. It was constantly bending to various political needs, various social needs around it. So you go to Kerala, Dilip Menon talks about how, you know, when the Brahmins first reached Malabar and the tribal areas there, they gave the tribes there certain customs from their side and they accepted some of those tribal customs. So in that region, the tribal customs have been taken by the Brahmins and the Brahmins have given their customs to some. In Coorg, there's a festival called Kundai, which basically means bum, which is a day when, you know, the local tribes show up and drag in the most flamboyant costumes and essentially come and insult the deity of the local temple. They're allowed to do that on that one day. It's not a curious festival, it's the remnant or it's an echo of about some historical moment when something was permitted. In Kerala, there's the Kodungallur temple where there was this festival where you could yell the most obscene things about the goddess. And I've heard some of these lyrics, you can't even quote them even in a liberal gathering like this. Very obscene lyrics. And you were allowed to desecrate the temple, throw in meat and blood and all of that. The theory is that this particular temple used to be a Buddhist vihara. And nuns used to stay there. The obscene songs refer to a time when they were driven out like that and the temple was taken over. So to commemorate that, that date is still honored where you go in and sort of shout obscenities and desecrate the temple. So there's a lot of sociology, anthropology, there's lots of history that's tied to religion. And religion, Hinduism specifically, wasn't a religion of the book. Till the British came and said, books are important. We have the Bible, the Jews have theirs, the Muslims have the Quran and so on. Hindus never had this preoccupation with books. Suddenly we started getting interested in books. So suddenly the Gita became a very important thing. And it's, you know, this I'm going to talk about in my next book, for example, about how the Gita, the value the Gita got, it exists in the main version of the epics, but it doesn't actually exist in a lot of the provincial versions. In the Kamban Ramayana, in the South Indian Mahabharata versions, the various state versions that were used locally, the Gita doesn't exist. But the Gita became the main Hindu text because at one point we decided texts are important, we need to elevate books, and therefore this was a wonderful book. The British respected the Gita. They were going crazy translating it because they loved it so much. So we said, great, this has become our book for the time. The Manusmriti was called the Hindu law book. But in reality, nothing was actually, legal disputes were determined on the basis of local custom, not on the basis of one book. There was no constitution 100 years ago. So the Manusmriti was just there. Nobody was actually referring to the Manusmriti except in a few cases in a few orthodox courts. But the British came and said, we must have books. Where is the original Hindu law book? So they elevated the Manusmriti. I have a theory that if the Arthashastra was discovered only in 1915 in Mysore, if they had discovered that first, they would have called that the Hindu law book. Because this one was discovered first, they decided, or the British found this one first, they said, let's elevate this one as the Hindu law book. Whereas there was no the Hindu law book. There was no such notion. So a lot of what we now take for granted as if Hinduism is what comes from the Vedas. Hinduism is what comes from these texts. That is an occupation, preoccupation with the text that comes from the 19th century. In reality, Hinduism is folklore. It's these local customs. It's these songs. It's these legends. It's these local festivals which you won't find in any books. It is the books plus all this. And there's an author called Tony Joseph who talks about how Hinduism is not a one-source culture. It's not emerged from one fount. It's got many founts, and together is what it forms, is what we call Hinduism. It's not something that emerged out of one source or one corpus or one text alone. And that, again, is not a popular thing to say these days, because now everything is about going back to the original.
Yeah, my question would be, when you were trying to portray Mahatma Gandhi's imaginary life for 125 years. But my question is on the Congress Party as such, which was created at the behest of Britishers to achieve independence for the country. And even Gandhiji had stated that the party should be disbanded after achieving its purpose of freedom. But why was it continued? And what are the implications of its continuation? And instead of continuing it, had a new party was created to get into the politics of the country.
Even this is the thing, right? Once enticed by power, it was very difficult to give it up. And the other thing was also stability. Now the Congress existed, you had Congress units, they were spread across the country, in every state, every district, every block there was a Congress unit. Who was going to dismantle it and create a new party? Plus, as I said, by the late 1930s, they were in power in 8 provinces. They already discovered the advantages of power. They already in the late 30s, a decade before independence, they had understood patronage system. They understood, and the complaints are staggering. It's so similar to today, where the complaints are like, oh, this Congress party worker has been working for so long, but this other person is connected to the head of the party here, so he's been promoted over this one. These are the same complaints you hear even today, because already in the 1930s, this had started afflicting the party. So although romantically they were supposed to sort of give up or whatever and become a new thing afterwards, once they achieved independence and once they got that taste of power, even before independence, I don't think that was ever an option for them, really speaking. Gandhiji could talk in the abstract in these terms, but the Congress party and the people in it, they had worked and they had ambition. Whether it's a Nehru, whether it's a Patel, these people had given their lives for it. Why were they suddenly going to become sannyasis and take a back seat? I don't think that was a, you know, they were also human beings. They also had their sense of ambition.
Get away from politics, but should have created a new party.
They were so well entrenched, they had so many advantages, and they dominated the system. So scholars call it the Congress system. The first 30-40 years of independence is the Congress system. Basically, anybody you don't like, incorporate them into the Congress, which is why the Congress lost ideology also. In different states, different regions, they became different things, because they just kept incorporating various, all kinds of elements into the party. And look at the earliest elections in free India after the constitution in the early 50s. That first election, there's Milan Vaishnav's book called When Crime Pays. It talks about how criminality was part of Indian elections from day one. From the first election, we have episodes of booth capturing, ballot box stuffing, all of this happening. So from the first day itself, none of them were, I don't think, romantically wedded to any notion that, oh, we will now sacrifice this organization we've built up and start a new one. They knew exactly what they wanted, which was power.
We'll take one last question.
Hello. So my question is, if Hinduism is so diverse, how do you find a commonality? Like, how is a North Indian somewhere in Bihar a Hindu and a South Indian in Hyderabad also a Hindu? So what is the common aspect of it? And the second question is, how do you comment on the Aryan invasion theory?
I don't think anyone takes an invasion seriously anymore. What they talk about is a migration. And that migration is not surprising. People object to it when they look at India in isolation, saying, oh, you're saying foreigners came into India, whatever. But if you look at the world at that time, you find that they weren't merely coming to India. There was a fanning out from one source. One set went into Europe, one set went into Persia, one set came to India. So if you look at only India, you're going to sit all day long fighting about whether or not the Aryans invaded the country. It happened over 7-8 centuries. These are groups of people moving slowly over time, not in one go. It wasn't one swift army that came and took over or whatever. But if you look at it in the larger perspective of the world, you see the same thing happening in other parts of the world as well. The same set of people are going to different areas, which is why you have this Indo-European language family. Because these three sets that broke off and went to three different areas, their ancestors spoke a common tongue, which is why the languages evolved separately, but they have common origins. So there's that to begin with. The other thing is also archaeological evidence. As I say, the Rig Veda talks about destroying the phallus worshippers, and it talks about phallus worshippers living in big cities, fortified cities. Now look at the Harappa ruins, it's full of phallus images. The Harappans did have phalluses thing, and they were in urban culture. Everything in the Vedic, the early Vedic corpus refers to a nomadic culture. It's not referring to an urban culture. It's talking about people moving around. It's a pastoral, changing, moving culture. But they make their peace. So by, as I said, by the time you come to the Atharva Veda, they've made their peace with the cities, they made their peace with the idols, they made their peace, and they have adapted. They have changed. And people think that saying that the Aryans is not the right scientific word, but I'll use it here. The Aryans came from outside means that the Vedas are foreign. They're not. The Rig Veda may have been written somewhere in the early stages of their travel here, but all the rest of the Vedic corpus was written in India in conjunction with whatever was already happening here. So it was very much an Indian creation, but I don't think we need to be upset about the fact that they came. There are various migrations. There's the out of India migration, there's the migration that happened from the eastern side, the Mundas and so on. They are another wave of immigrants who came in. There are multiple waves. Even the people in Harappa were not some pristine Indian group. They were a mix of Iranian hunter-gatherers with the local people who were already here. They're the ones who built the big cities. There are four, I think, such big waves that happened. The so-called Aryan immigration is merely one of them. So if you look at only that and people get politically carried away, then you're looking at it in isolation. Look at the larger picture, you get the fuller sense. As for what do we have in common, I think there was a civilizational sense of unity in the subcontinent. You go to any corner, you have a version of the Ramayana. You go to any corner, you have a version of the Mahabharata. Even the Muslims of Kerala have a version of the Ramayana, for example, as I said. And there's something called, Diana Eck, the scholar, calls it sacred geographies, where she talks about how these pilgrim routes exist, connecting different corners of the country on the same pilgrim routes. And that is interesting. But sacred geography is also interesting for another reason. I was recently reading about how in Thailand, you know, they have Rama and they worship and venerate the Ramayana there. They have a sacred geography there. People there will point at a hill saying that's where Hanuman got the Sanjeevani, this is where Sita was abducted from, etc. We have places like that. You go to Nasik, there's Panchavati from where she was abducted. Locals will tell you that. The Thai have their own version of where she was abducted from. Because this story so energized people, they started applying that to their local geography. So you go to different parts of the country, they'll say this is where Jatayu's wings, a part of his wings fell. When Sati was chopped, I think, into pieces, different parts of her body fell in different places. All of these are trying to create some sort of a civilizational link between these people. And the other thing is, although even in Banaras alone, there are over 100 varieties of Brahmins, and all of them claim to be superior than the other, the existence of Brahmins in different parts of the country, speaking one, well, sacred language, which is Sanskrit, and venerating one set of text also creates a certain thread. It's not enough to call it nationalism or people were not, diversity was there, but the Brahmins gave a certain outline by their existence everywhere. Their own divisions were there, their own feuds were there, but their existence everywhere did create a certain outline, which is what I call civilizational unity. There was a civilizational unity. People knew Paschim, Dakhan, you know, the peninsula and all of that. People knew that geography, and they were aware that this was largely one sort of cultural zone.
So you talked about
They're three very good scholars on Mughals, for example. Now Ira Mukoti has written a book on Mughal women, and you again have this notion that Mughal women were basically lounging about all day in the harem, you know, draped in pearls, in silks, and wearing pearls and sort of doing nothing much. But in reality, they were Akbar's wife, the so-called Jodhabai. Her actual name was not Jodhabai. This Rajput lady, she was a big shipping magnate. The Rahimi, which was one of the world's biggest ships of the time, belonged to this Rajput lady. She had a cavalry rank of 12,000. She used to issue farmans of her own. Her agents used to go into all the big markets of India and actually transact trade. And she used to remain in the loop about this. When the English agent in Bayana outbid the Begum, this Rajput lady in the indigo market of Bayana, she had the English thrown out. Because she said, how dare you outbid the empress? She was not some lady lounging about in the palace. She was a trading woman. She was a woman of great power and resourcefulness. Emperor Humayun lost a daughter who drowned to death next to a battle scene in a river. What was a six-year-old girl doing in the battlefield? Which meant these women used to travel to the battlefield with the men. Babur had a sister who came on a horse. Many decades after he had to hand her over to a conqueror, she came back to him many decades later. A lot of Mughal women used to play diplomatic roles. So a son starts a rebellion against the father, he loses. Now technically the emperor is supposed to chop his head off. It was the Mughal women who made sure that didn't happen. They would take the man by the neck, touch his head to the father's feet and say, "Acha, now this is over. The rebellion is over, you can get over this." So these Mughal women used to go out as diplomats and make peace when the royal family had internal dissensions and so on. They were active political figures, and Ira Mukherjee has written about it. So there are women starting to write about it, and the interesting thing is, you know, they're also highlighting quirks of these people. In this, I'll end with one final anecdote about Jahangir. And Jahangir was this extremely colorful man. We think of this emperor who was full of opium and alcohol and sort of didn't do much, and Noorjahan did everything. But he was a man of great curiosity. Someone once brought him a large watermelon, and its size was so astonishing, he had it measured. He went to Haridwar and they said this lake doesn't have a bottom. He'd sent in divers to actually measure the lake. There was a sannyasi who lived inside a cave and didn't talk to anybody. Jahangir somehow managed to squeeze through this narrow opening of the cave, and he would spend hours with that sannyasi talking to him, and he thought he was a really important spiritual leader. Jahangir commissioned paintings in which he appears like a Hindu yogi, you know, topless and wearing a dhoti, more like a Hindu god than a Muslim king. He had these curious things where in the Deccan he couldn't defeat Malik Ambar. So he commissioned a painting in which he's shooting an arrow at Malik Ambar's severed head, because what he couldn't achieve in real life, he wanted to achieve in art. And once, the most curious story is when someone brought him a zebra, and he was convinced it was a horse with paint on it. So he summoned lots of people with water to court and had water poured over the zebra constantly to see if the paint would wear off, because he was completely fascinated by it. Another courtier of his was dying, an opium addict was dying and completely emaciated, and he came to the emperor saying, I need leave to leave the court, I want to go back and die in peace in my house. And Jahangir says, fine, but you look so horrifying, I want a portrait made of you first for future reference. So Jahangir got the portrait made, and it still exists. And there's this English account left by an ambassador who goes out to camp. Jahangir is not in the palace, he's camping somewhere. So he goes out to meet the emperor there. And he goes there in the evening and he discovers that the lights have all been put out. And he's wondering why the lights have suddenly been put out. Turns out the emperor and his wife, Noorjahan, have decided to go out on a bullock cart together. And the emperor himself is flogging the bullocks and sort of riding the cart. And this Englishman was astonished to see the Badshah of the Mughal Empire, the richest sovereign of the world, driving a bullock cart with great glee with his wife. Because this man was also human. He had his quirks. He was a playful, curious man. And this sort of thing, as you humanize historical figures, the past also comes alive better. And I think that a lot of women scholars are also doing increasingly.